students are coming from big schools that have these big caseloads, and you can mention that. He's like, you can mention that in your letter, you know, based on, this is what I know about the student, and there's always going to be a couple students that stand out more, and you're going to vouch for a little bit more. It just happens that way. He's like, that's what we want to know. And we'll never use it against them if you really don't know the student. At least that's what they told me, so I don't know if that really happens. Questions about this? Why letter of recommendation? So, let's talk about counselor letters, because counselor letters and teacher letters are kind of different. They're very similar setup and template, but the content might be a little bit different. So the counselor usually has to do like a recommendation form, especially if you're doing a Common App. You do a recommendation form where you kind of rate the student, and you say, you know, three words that describe the student, and then you talk about their academics and personality, stuff like that, and you rate it on the scale. And they actually do look at that. When I went to go talk to Princeton, they told me that my first year that I was giving these ratings that I was a little harsh, but they thought that I was being overall harsh. And so they're like, okay, that's just how she grades. And so I was like, okay, I'll go to South, be nicer. And you usually have to send a transcript or a school profile if you are the main counselor for the Common App. If you're not, it's usually the college counselor can send it as well. And your letter of recommendation. So for the counselor, what they mentioned is that they want to see the student within the context of the school environment. Okay, because you as a counselor, you get to see the school in its entirety. You meet with lots of different students. You get to be a part of different meetings and decisions that take place in the school. So you understand how the school works. And so they want to know, what does the student look like within that environment? How do they stand out amongst other students? How do they stand out amongst those college-going students? Are they pretty to par? Do they stand out a lot? Have they had to take on a lot of other resources to help them out? So how do they look in the school community? This is your chance that if you know the student really well, you've worked with them for a number of years, they can talk about family situations and responsibilities. Like, we know a lot of our students, especially if they're the eldest, they are responsible for their siblings. They have to go home and babysit. They can't participate in extracurricular activities. They can't participate in this program or that program. So mentioning those things in here can help the student as well, right? Just to tell them their circumstances. And also, how they compare to other students. Also about their intellectual curiosity. You always get that question, a lot of questionnaires from private schools. What is their intellectual curiosity like, right? The whole point of this letter is to get them into college so that they will be students, so that they will be, you know, in academia. So what is it like for them, or how do they approach learning? And then again, just any specific circumstances or obstacles that you might know would be important as well, just to provide, again, more context. So you're providing context. Questions about the program? Teacher recommendations. So for the most part, teachers are going to do a teacher rec form, or very similar, what words describe the student, and you do ratings, right? Compared to your students in the past, whatever they've been like. And usually they ask for two letters of recommendation, and like Rebecca mentioned earlier, it's usually like the core teachers, which would be English and math and social science. And then preferably they want to know the student recently. So
11th grade, don't you think?
Yeah, 11th or 12th grade, or if they've known them over the 4 years, because maybe they worked with them outside as an advisor or whatever, that could work as well. But always refer the instructions, or refer the students to make sure that it's correct, and the instruction. And so the focus for a teacher should be more about the classroom. How is the student as a student, right? What is their performance? What is their personal characteristics like? And one of the things that a lot of the admissions people have told us is that to avoid listing extracurricular activities, because they already get that. A lot of times what they'll do is they'll look at the academics, they look at the extracurricular activities, and then the last thing is the personal statements and the letters of recommendations. So they kind of already know what the student's involved in. So you don't want to just list, oh, you know, they're so great because they do this, 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 and this, and this. Because they're just reiterating the same thing that they already read. So I usually use it if it's going to prove a point or emphasize a point or a type of characteristic that the student has. How are they going to benefit from a college education from so-and-so university, right? Questions? FERPA, you mentioned it before, all students should select yes. And FERPA is just, they are waiting FERPA. So they don't get to see the letters of recommendations. And I've asked some of the college admissions people, and they prefer this, obviously, because once they avoid a lot of issues, so the student can't see what the teacher said, because then the teacher, you know, the student is like, oh, you messed up my admissions process, and I didn't get it from you. But if they can't see it, they can't say that. And two, it actually allows the teacher to be more honest, that they feel like they can be more honest. So that way, whatever's being said is actually true, hopefully, right? So it allows them to be free to be candid on their letters of recommendation.
I mean, many of the private schools will not write a letter if they don't sign this agreement. I think that's a decision that you should probably make at the school site to say, we have a blank, and I saw one yesterday for a school that every senior had to sign it, we waive our rights, and this is the school policy. Because they don't understand that the college won't consider them if they don't waive their rights. So I just think you need to go to your leadership and say this year we need to have a blanket FERPA statement for everybody no matter what. They sign it on Naviance and then you're done.
Isn't that part of Naviance?
No, but if they're applying to University of Texas or if they're applying to University of Georgia or any school that doesn't have a waiver through the Common App,
right?
The waiver only works with the Common App on Naviance. But they're applying to EOP, that waiver's not there. The waiver's... That's why I just think you need to on Naviance, pop up a little wave, and I saw it. I waive my rights, my parents understand it, you sign your birth date, you sign your day, and then you're done. That was it. They still have to do it with the other places, but that's between your agreement and the school. Because I know that Harvard was, like, parents have tried to sue, and the law states that that FERPA agreement was signed, there's no way you can go.
I've never had issues with it, but I can see how.
No.
Yeah. So, FERPA, have them waive it, and then do okay. And then, so what, the big issue about writing letters of recommendation, if you have a caseload of 5, does anybody have more than 500 on their caseload?
That you'd have to write 500 letters.
And so, you know, it shows that, like, I can still see these students individually, and, you know, it's like a conveyor belt, you can still see them. So, how do you write a personal letter that provides context, that provides characteristics of the student, and it's really, really hard, and the best friend is going to be your brag sheet. Your brag sheet is going to be so important when you're writing your letter of recommendation, because you don't know all the students. Like, my caseload is a little bit smaller, because I have a smaller school, I have about 230 seniors, but even then, I don't know all of them on a personal level. So the brag sheet really helps. So what it is, it's a questionnaire or a survey just to gather information from the student. And even the students that I do know a little bit better, I always find something new. I'm like, oh, I didn't know that. And they give you an opportunity to learn about them in an efficient way because you just have them do the survey or the brag sheet. And then when you're ready to write your letter, you have it handy to you. You can also use it to gather information about the students and using your letter, and it can be tailored to what you like to write in your letters. If you like to focus more on home life, or if you like to focus more in your classroom, or if you like to focus more on things that the student doesn't do outside, you can kind of format it that way so it kind of brings that to light from the students when they answer their questions. Also, some ideas. Usually if they have a student brag sheet, there's also parent brag sheets, which I find helpful because parents love to brag about their students. Students aren't always the best braggers. And they always talk about all these other things that the student didn't talk about. And then peer brag sheets, that's a kind of iffy, depends on the student, depends on the friend. So you can have it in there.
But I was gonna ask Antonio. Antonio, how many of your parents will fill out a really fleshed out brag sheet? Do you think a buddy would? Do you think one of their best friends would?
Yeah, and I was just thinking that I think we probably, as a school and as a staff, we probably need to more work.
I would call it peer slash kin. So it could be their cousin, it could be their uncle, it could be anybody who knows them or a friend.
Yeah.
I'm thinking about it for not, you know, upper middle class schools, but for the schools where the parents.
And I think just the same, the word brag, a lot of the time.
Yes, and I've seen.
Right, yeah.
So Dartmouth and Davidson have these peer letters, and I've seen them, and they're better than anything I've ever seen ever.
One of the things that I've done is I tell kids, tell parents that they can write it in Spanish.
Yeah.
And then it was Filipino, and I can't.
The other thing I've thought about is putting the parent letter under the student responsibility and the parent responsibility so that literally the student could go home and interview their parent and write it for them.
But I think even coming up with things that you know that they may not be thinking about that they can put in there, a lot of the times it's really hard if they're not coached.
That's right.
So look at some
that's right. So that's why I love the idea of peer letters right now, because I think the person who knows them better, somebody sitting next to them on ASB, or somebody who's like at Southeast, they're on the marching band together at 4 o'clock in the morning going to the Rose Bowl. So it would just be another thing that you could add in as opposed to replace it.
Just a note, I think like the peer and parent bribe sheets, it really depends on your school.
Yeah, that's right, that's right.
Your school. I know at my school, the parent bribe sheet, it just wouldn't work. I think the peer ones would be the best option.
So open up the world so that you can do that.
So, and I had never thought of that until, you know, we sat down and, you know, Erica works with a very different
that's
population.
That's right. That's why I think each population is going to be different.
Very different. So, you know, I had never thought about that until we started working on this, and now I'll be able to go back to my school and, you know, start this process with my students.
The other thing is, some schools are now asking teachers at the end of junior year just to write one paragraph about the kid, so that the counselors during the summer can try to equally distribute some kids who are going to have a hard time getting recommendations. And then you can literally copy that paragraph right into the recommendation. I mean, I'm just thinking that sometimes teachers don't know.
How do you save the word?
What?
Or is it spread or save?
You can do it in Anya. You can have a survey for teachers. You can have a survey for anybody at your school, right? The nice thing about Naviance is because your teachers are now invited, they can do everything.
So, like I tell my kids, the more information you provide to me, the better your letter of recommendation will be. And I keep stressing that over. Every time I see that over and over again.
One last thing is, I know that a bunch of schools have a second brag sheet that they put out in the fall, just about what they did during the summer. Because a lot of the kids do really interesting things over the summer between junior and senior year. Did they have a job? Did they help their parents? Did they work with kids? And they ultimately give you much more information, just a summer brag sheet.
Yeah, with Naviance, what I do is with my 10th grader, there's a questionnaire that they have to do just to kind of get them thinking about what they want to do in college. And then junior year, have a little bit more formal about either extracurricular activities, and then, you know, what colleges they see themselves and what they want from a college. And then senior year, fall, is when I do the brag sheet, because usually during the summer is when they do a lot of things. And it's just to get them in a mode of using and doing surveys and you know, questionnaires. So it helps to do it early, so they get used to answering those questions. And then I also require a resume, because I'm not going to, you can put your resume. And what's that? So the brag sheet and the resume. Helps a lot. It makes it so much faster. So these are just some sample questions on the Google Classroom. We posted the latest brag sheet that I use. It's work in progress, because every year I feel like there's other questions that I come up with or things that I want to tweak, or maybe like I see a trend that the students are, you know, answering the same thing for the same question. So it's always under construction. So, you know, choose 3 words to describe yourself and give an example as to why. What has been your favorite subject and why? What is important to you? I really like this question, because you get really unique answers, like what are you passionate about, what is important to you? And you get, you know, my family, or you know, getting a career, so you get a little bit of everything. Do you have a career in mind, and how have you prepared for it? So this is nice, because then you can attach, like, this is their goal, and these are the things that they've been doing. What has been your biggest challenge during high school? It's always a good question, because usually, the most common answer is always going to be my chemistry class was really, really hard, and I tried my best, and blah, blah, blah. Once in a while, you're going to get those little nuggets of like, oh, this was going on in my family and it affected me, but I overcame it or whatever. Are there any circumstances that you believe affected your academics, positive or negative? Always get both. And then what do you usually do, where do you usually do your homework? And I got this question from a colleague, because you get to learn a little from there. Like, if they're doing it at their desk, you know, in their room, I mean, they have that available to them. But you hear students like, I'm doing it in my living room while I'm taking care of my brothers and sisters and they're watching TV. Or like, I have to wait until everybody goes to bed and do my homework at 11 o'clock at night when I can actually be nice and quiet. Or like, I have to go to the library because there's no internet in my house. So you get little questions, little things here and there that you can follow up with. You don't just use the rec sheet, just the rec sheet. You can always follow up with students and like, oh, tell me a little bit more so I can, you know, learn about you. So that can help. And then during your free time, what do you like to do? If you could write a paragraph, oh, I love this question. If you could write a paragraph in your letter of recommendation, what would it say? This helps me so much because it kind of sets the tone as to what the student wants to portray on their letter of recommendation or to the admissions office. And so it helps you to kind of start the letter. Sometimes for me, I'm not the greatest writer, but it's getting started is the hardest part for me, right? This kind of sets the tone for me and it's like, okay, I can do the rest of it. Or I can fix it or, you know, cut it into three different ways and put more examples and stuff like that. So it really sets the tone.
I also give them a listing of positive personality adjectives. And I post it in Aviance because they don't know these words, but there are lists. There are many lists out there. You can find a list that you like the best. Alphabetical, personal, you know, and they can all go to that list and then think, oh yeah, I really am ingenious. I really am cooperative. I really am just positive personality adjectives because they get stuck.
And on Aviance, there's a quiz or questionnaire.
Yep.
It's called Strength Finder. I usually have the 11th graders do that one. It's a really long questionnaire, but it has all these different words and adjectives that the students can later use to describe themselves. Some of them describe themselves and then they say shy or quiet. And then when you read what they're doing, it's like, no, you're not shy. So it's interesting to see it that way. And then we have some do's and don'ts. So do personalize your letter as much as possible. Admissions people know that some schools it's just not possible, so they understand that, but as much as you can, especially for students that you really, really want to badge for, personalize it. Include anecdotes or examples of students' effort in class. That's really helpful because then it shows that you're not just being generic and you're just not saying, oh, they're great students. You're actually showing the admissions committee that they are exceptional students. Explain your position and your relationship to them, especially if it goes beyond the classroom. Like, you're the advisor of their club, or you're the coach, or they work with an organization that you're a part of. That shows that you know the student more than just in your classroom, so you get to see them in different environments. Try to keep it to one page. It's going to spill over a lot of times because some kids just have, you know, they're so great that it goes over. And use letterhead. I notice a lot of teachers don't use letterhead. It just makes it more official. You know, sometimes it's how things look. Provide contact information in case they need to contact you. On very rare occasions, they might contact you. Use the correct name, especially if you're copy and pasting. I understand I copy and paste a lot. So you have to be careful of the pronouns and the names and things like that. So, you know, read it over before you send it out. Don't reuse and rewrite generic letters. Try not to, especially if you know, usually what I have the students write in the rag sheet is where they're applying. That way, if I know some students are all applying there, I try to make a point not to make the exact same letter. Because remember, it's the same person that leads all of them from that region. So if you're writing the same letter, they're going to know. And then they're just going to be like, well, that doesn't really mean anything, so I'm not going to look at those letters, right? And then all your other ones for nothing. Try not to mention any weaknesses unless the student turned it into a positive, just because, you know, we're trying not to get them in. You don't want to say, like, the student, you know, doesn't do their work or doesn't do that, because then it affects the admission decision. Negative references. If you can't say anything nice, then don't say anything at all, and it's okay to say no. I get a lot of teachers that come to me and it's like, you know, so-and-so asked me for a letter, but they cheated in my class, and I don't have anything nice. I said, well, then just say no. Like, they can find somebody else. Just say no. Don't make too many spelling mistakes or too many typos. They're not grading you, but, you know, it's like every other word is misspelled. You know, make it flow. Don't write a one-paragraph letter. Mm-hmm. I see that so much. It hurts me because it's like, no, like, these kids are asking me for you to vouch for them, and you're just writing one letter, one paragraph, it didn't really say anything, it wasn't even worth your time. Don't be too vague or too general. Include college names. Don't include college names because a lot of letters are going to be reused for other colleges, especially for the Common App. That same letter will go to all 20 schools if they're applying to 20 schools. So try to avoid the institution's name. And then also it helps you because later on, if the student asks you for a letter of recommendation for scholarships or internships, it's generic enough that it doesn't refer to any institution, right? So they can use it. And then we have a clue going on there. Best practices, always save a copy so that it can be changed to modify. That helps a lot. Because sometimes they'll ask for, I need this scholarship, or I know I've had students that use the letter to apply for positions, and like, oh, they really want to know about this, can you add this? And I have a copy and it's just easy to add it. Give multiple hard copies. Usually when a student comes to me for a letter for a scholarship, I give them at least 4 or 5 copies, because that way they don't come to me every nutrition and give me a copy. And it kind of encourages them, it's like, oh, I can apply to more. Make sure to be clear of your procedures. That's really important. Since I know it gets overwhelming, the school year takes over, and you said yes to this kid in September, but then if you forgot, and then it's already January 1st when it's due, and they're emailing you like crazy during the break. So be clear with how you want them to let you know, how you want them to remind you, because I don't get busy, and I have kids that come to me, like, they ask me on Monday, and they're like, coming on Tuesday, like, did you write it? It's like, I didn't even get a chance to sit down. So, you know, it's going to get done by the deadline, as I usually tell them. It's perfectly fine to say no, especially if you have nothing nice to say or good to say, okay? So that's really important as well. And then, again, it's part of the application process. So it is important. They wouldn't be asking for it. They weren't going to use it at all. And I've always heard, a lot of the admissions people have said, it's not going to be used against the student unless it's like something like super glaringly negative. But for the most part, it doesn't hurt the student. It's not that great of a letter if it gives you any consolation.
So if a kid has been accused of cheating, or if a kid has gotten arrested, or if a kid has done something, and they have to report it, do you feel that you need to address it also in your letter?
If it's, like, if it happened before their senior year?
No. If it's in the common application very clearly says, if you have done anything that has gotten you removed from school, or had a consequence, like cheating, or getting into a fight, or I had a kid get into a fight 3 times in high school. So I thought I had to address it. And to say, you know, he had 3 fights in high school, I know he's addressing it in it, he's grown up now, he's no longer a 9th grade boy,
yeah.
You know, and do you address it and tell them, do you have conversations?
I haven't had that situation yet.
I
have. But
how do you address it?
If it affected their academics, or they're expecting something related to school, the relationships or what have you with adults, that
mm-hmm.
would address it.
What if they have a learning disability and it can only help the admissions officer to know that they work really well in an included classroom? Do you ask permission to do it? How do you handle it?
For that one, I don't ask. I only include it if the student's going to talk about
okay.
it. Because usually I've talked to them, or they mention it in a
yeah,
sheet. If
okay.
they're mentioning to me, that means they're giving me permission.
Okay.
Especially like last year, I had 2 students that they didn't get diagnosed with ADHD until they're like end of their 10th grade.
Mm-hmm.
So their grades, you can see in their transcript. So things like that, I emphasize again that, you know, there's a difference because of this diagnosis.
What's the district policy on releasing that information? Because I know one of the options is saying my district doesn't allow, our school policy doesn't allow us to release that information.
It's only if the kid
yeah.
gives you permission to talk about it, can you do it?
The kid or the parents?
As soon as the student turns 18 years old, then the student has all
yeah.
the rights.
So underneath has to be the parent.
But they might not.
But how do you
but I mean, how do we document that?
Yeah,
how do we
yeah.
Like, I know there's an option saying for them to call you, but even
yeah,
if
yeah.
they call you, what can I say?
Well, I mean, you're going to have to, if you feel the need that you need to talk about it, then you're just going to have to call the parent and say, just, can you give me permission?
But what's the district policy on
that?
For letters of recommendation, there is no district policy.
But then another recommendation, this is like, they're giving them information about their academic, about their behavioral record. Basically.
Well, because when they do the application, like I know on the Common App, it has that question that you give permission for your school to release information or about academics
mm-hmm.
and things like that.
So we protect the FERPA.
So we're
protected. Absolutely. If you do that FERPA, if you do
yeah.
the FERPA thing, you're protected.
But
still,
those two?
Yes. But disability rights are disability rights. You can't write about it unless you have permission.
And you can always ask the student. I've had, you know, situations like where the student's talking about family, drug addictions, and all that stuff. And she wrote it in her brag sheet. And so, one, I called in just to make sure everything was okay. And she said, and I told her, like, is it okay if I write about this? Because I feel like it's a big part of your life. And then she kind of went on to do other things with that, like what she learned from there. And she was like, sure. You can. So you can always ask the student. If you feel like it's really touchy, then you can call the parents.
The other thing that you can do is you can call the college, right? So a lot of people will say, you know, I can't put it in the letter, but I have permission to call you and tell you about it. And the admissions officers of the college, not the UCs, but the private colleges will listen to you and say, great. But you can't talk about an eating disorder if they don't tell you permission to talk about an eating disorder.
And it has to do with why they're applying.
That's right.
It's for college
admission, right.
So if it has nothing to do with, you know, they're fine and they kind of overcame it, then
but you can't talk about anything. I had a kid at a school who had tried to kill himself and was really doing well, and the counselor wanted to know if he could talk about it, and it's like, absolutely not.
Yeah.
That's completely and 100% only belonging to the kid. Unless the kid and the parent give you permission to talk about it.
Yeah, but I'm thinking more about like getting students got into fights, students have been arrested.
They have to report it on the common application. A box opens up where they have to explain it.
Themselves have to check
out. 250 words in some cases, 400 words another. But it, if you know enough to say, you know, in the ninth grade version of him is not the 11th grade version of him, so I highly encourage you to just see him for who he's blossomed into. But that's only if they give you permission.
And sometimes it can be a little general too, if you don't want to divulge everything. You just, like I said, like, you know,
mm-hmm.
You don't have to go into the super details and just say, but now this is who he is or who the person is. You don't have to go into super details. You don't feel comfortable.
The other thing I've been told that you do is you put in the letter, if you really want more information about this, I encourage you to call me.
Yeah.
And then they'll get the phone call knowing that you can't put it in the letter and that you can put it on the phone.
Yeah.
Especially like with a kid with an eating disorder or a kid who has emotional challenges. I tend to never talk about that because the college won't take them.
What do you do in this? I've never had this situation, but if you have a student that you really don't recommend, like it would be bad for the student if they went off. I've never had that situation, but I think about it. Like if there's any
well, the nice thing about the common application is this year they're allowing somebody else to write the letter. It doesn't have to be you.
What I've done is
so
I write a very
general
letter saying really not much about this kid. I just submit it.
I think, in this sense, you need to sit down with the kid and explain it.
Right. Well, no, and I just, at first I just, it's not a good fit for you, and then I go and write them, you know, they're very adamant about me.
So what I do, what I've seen schools do, and say, this is the letter I'm going to write, I highly encourage you to apply to the University of California where there are no letters. No, seriously, because this happens all the time with these schools, where the kid has gotten into profound trouble all the way through, and you've seen them because you're the counselor, you know him, and you can't recommend them, and it's against, I'm trying to figure out how to get this to go back up. But that's a special situation where we could form a little committee to, I love how she's tall.
Yeah.
No, but I think this is something that we could get together in the district and have, you know, policies about this so that you're not going to get in trouble because you did it. But I don't know.
Have you dealt with plagiarism and that, you know, we had a policy where we said, after being accused of plagiarism, the school is not writing their recommendation.
Uh-oh. Mm-hmm. That's a hard one. Because once a cheater, always a cheater. But and yet I had a kid that I worked with who in 10th grade was part of a cheating scandal at his high school, where there were a group of kids who were able to get the older siblings' tests, and then they sold them throughout the school.
Whoa.
Entrepreneurs. So the school says we have to address it in our letter. We highly encourage you to focus your common application essay on this. And he did. And he got into Michigan. Because what they want is remorse.
Mm-hmm.
They want reflection.
She learns something.
That's right. That's right. Happens all the time. I had a kid. What are you gonna do with these kids who were caught joyriding, and they're the people who were the police little interns that you know.
Yeah.
Some of them are gonna want to go to college, and they're gonna have to say yes. I was arrested. I'm thinking, well, what did you learn? Yeah, I mean, yeah, that's up to you, but I do believe there's schools in the Cal States and there are different schools that don't require recommendations that you can. But the other thing is to make sure that they're in treatment for their cheating, because they need to not cheat anymore. The colleges say that if they did it in 10th grade, okay. If they did it in 11th grade, problem. Like, there was an administrator who said that they had a dance, and the kid in 9th grade came up and at the dance was so drunk he threw up on the administrator's shoes. And he said, you know what, he was in 9th grade, I'm not writing about it. If it had happened in 11th grade, he would have written about it. He's like, because 9th graders, I don't count anything against them. So I think that's
okay.
So I put this under sample brag sheets and that letters. And I added also Hallie's as well as Lisa's.
So this letter is about Gabriel. Gabriel is an outstanding student who's at Brown now. But he is a Latino student, and at Lisa's, if you don't know about Lisa's is like 50% students that are free or reduced lunch and 50 that don't need it. So then you know they're doing well. And one of the things that when you start looking at the data at LACES is that you start to see a trend that the top students tend not to be the Latino students or the African American students. So that's one of the things that I actually, because he was 4 in the whole class, and so I mentioned that a lot of Latino students and African American students tend not to be in the top half of the school, but he made it, he did it, and you know, with his efforts, he studied, he took a whole bunch of community college courses, he took where you did like independent study for different science classes, things like that. So he really went beyond what was being offered at the school. So I talked about that. And then because we are a community school and he lived in South Cape, or HP, one of those, going all the way to the west side on Fairfax and Washington. So I really stressed how he had to do this every day, every morning, every afternoon for 6, 7 years since sixth grade he's been going to LACES. So, and I mentioned that this is what he wanted to do. He knew that his community was not going to offer everything that he wanted, so this is what he had to do in order to get that education that would prepare him, that he felt would prepare him. So I talk about that a little bit. I talk about how the school sees him. He was in a lot of organizations. When you talk to him when you talk to teachers about him, they all had positive things to say. So I included that in there as well. And this is only after like a month or two of knowing him, because this is my first year at LACES. So I didn't know him like extremely well, but I did talk to some people, and they mentioned this and that and that. So I made sure that I included that. And I also told them that I didn't know him very well, but from my impressions, these are the things I've already gathered. So you can only imagine what kind of student he is. So I think it was a pretty good letter. It was easy to write this one because he was so good. and some of them were easier than others. This is a teacher letter recommendation. I like this one because the teacher really went with it. This is the teacher that teaches the AP seminar class, and this senior class was the first class that was gonna finish the AP seminar process, which was the two classes. So she really worked with these students a lot. And so one of the things she said, what do you get when you cross an airplane pilot and an opera singer, mom and dad? You get Jessica Lee Paz. So she was really kind of showing where the student is coming from, the background that she has. And she really goes into talking about how she gets really excited about things, if it's talking about her class work or talking about going to Coachella, like she gets really excited about life. Then she goes and talks about what she's working on in her AP seminar class, which is they have to actually do a research project, and how she did some research on the NFL, head injuries and things like that. And so she talked about the process, that it wasn't just, you know, doing the science, that she's doing a research paper. And then she even, you know, talks about some anecdotes throughout the year. She talks about a presenter that came in and she presenter, and she like kind of shared her emotions and like I really felt what she said. As he spoke, I could see myself doing exactly what he does. You know, so how she really connects with people that are giving her information, that she really learns from these presenters. So I thought this was a really good letter because it felt very personal. Like nobody else would be able to write this letter unless you were that teacher in that classroom, right? So that was a good one. Here's a one that's a little bit more general. Here, this one, the teacher's talking about a student, and this is a little bit more like general and generic. Generic in the sense that like it has the parts of what the student does and the characteristics, but what I did like is that the bottom, he starts to talk about that he does a lot of Socratic seminars and how she gives a lot of input. And that when she gives a lot of the input at the seminars, that he notices that a lot of students take notes while she's talking. Means like that doesn't happen very often, that when a student is talking, they take notes. And it's just to show like how much input and how much thought she puts into what she's saying in the classroom, that she participates in the classroom. And he goes on to really recommend her because she's been such a great addition to his class and how he's going to be a great addition to the university that she decides to go to. And he says a little bit of things that she's been involved in. So it just a lot of good, positive words for being used. So that stays with the reader. So that when they're in committee and they're saying, well, why should we take the student? Oh, because she's, you know, eloquent and she's strong-minded and, you know, her peers take what she says and they go with it. Or they, you know, things like that. Or the student is admired by the faculty and he's been a great addition to the school community. So that's why we should take them on, because they're gonna do the same thing in our college, okay? So these are examples. Try not to use them. I know some of the names are in there. Some of them are not. They are some of my students, but I trust you guys. this is my brag sheet and how it looks like. This is how it shows up on Naviance. It's just really the questions in the little box. I have some check boxes, like you know, if they're first generation, if they're low income, if they're immigrant family. If they're international students, these are just questions that kind of set the tone of where the student is coming from. If they're legacy in any college, do some of the private students like that. So I try to mention it in my letter if that's the case. What are the words or phrases that describe them? Just other questions that'll help the student just talk about themselves as much as possible. Like I said, I feel like I'm gonna change it up a little bit. One of the things that I was talking to one admissions person, I think I might add to my rec sheet, is making the colleges right now are a lot about fit. You hear that always over and over. We wanna make sure the student is a good fit. So like, how do you show you're a good fit? And one of the things that admissions person said is that each college has a mission statement. So the student should be looking at that mission statement or the values of that college. Or even yesterday when we were talking to the student that's from Pitzer, she knew the values right away. So how are you as a student portraying those characteristics that fit that mission or those values? So I feel like for this year, what I'm gonna test out is have a student put the mission statement of their college that they really, really wanna go to, and how, like three examples of how they fit that mission or statement. I feel that'll give me a little bit more to talk about. So I'll test it out. I don't know how it's gonna go.
My only other recommendation, Erica, is to group the questions in categories. Like to do all your academic ones together, all your extracurricular ones together, all your family ones together. Because as the kid is filling it out, it's so much easier for them to stick thematically.
Yeah. And then put the easy ones first.
Yes.
Because I feel like once they've like done the check mark ones, they're like, oh, well, let me just finish the rest.
Naviance also allows you to star. And a red star means they have to complete it.
Mm-hmm.
And an item without a star, they don't have to complete. So think about not having, everything should be required. Because let me tell you, if it's not required, they're not gonna do it.
Yeah. I get interesting responses. I had one kid tell me, I don't think he understood I was gonna read these. And he's like, why are they asking so many personal questions? Like, it's a brag sheet for your letter recommendation. And so I had to talk to them, like, oh, I didn't know you were gonna see it. Like, okay. I also want to show you what it looks like.
she'll be there. I don't think I can.
There it is. So when you go into Navion, this is your the profile. It's gonna look like this. You type in the student's name where it says search for student, and then this is their profile. There's a whole bunch of tabs that you can look at. Once the student completes the actual survey or questionnaire, you click on plan, and it'll show you everything that they completed and when they completed it, and you just click on it. So if I want to go to their senior survey, I click on it, and then it shows me their responses. So from here is where I start writing my letters of recommendation. This is the senior survey, sorry, not the rec sheet. But then you can get your responses from here. When you're actually creating it, you have to go to where it says connections and surveys. So they're technically surveys. And here, because I already have them made, I can just reassign them to students, so I don't have to re-embed it. I can just go and modify it, or you can create a new survey. So if I just want to go and modify it, I can go to student brag sheet, and I can reassign it to students, whatever grade level, put a little blurb about why this is important and when it's due, and then I can also edit the questions. In editing the questions, here tells you the order, so you can change them around and move them around. And then you can do short text, you can do essays, you can do yes or no questions, you can do select from a list, things like that. So it's up to you how you want to make the question. And then here's what Rebecca was talking about, making it required or not. And then you just type in your question in this section. And so it'll add to that list, and then you can reformat it to whatever order you want. And edit your survey.
In Naviance also, you can decide where it goes. So usually they're in the tab that says about me. But sometimes teachers put them under documents.
Yeah.
So in your school, you're gonna need to figure out where you're gonna put it and how all the kids know exactly where to go.
I keep it under the tasks, like where it says, they have colleges, so this is where they do all the searching and where they're actually applying. And then about me, where it says tasks, is where I assign, you can assign it. So by grade level, you can say this is due by a certain time if it's required. So the student graduated this year, so she's done all the stuff. So if it has a star, it means it's super required by Ms. Lopez, and you're supposed to do it. And then the cap is that it's required for graduation. If you don't do it, then you're not going to get your graduation. You know, they're still going to graduate. So it just kind of stresses that, and they can see what they've completed. And on here, if they haven't completed something, it'll say incomplete or need to still complete or whatever, and they just click and finish it.
Also, at the bottom, there's buttons you can put whether they can, I want to keep on editing it or I'm finished with it. And I highly recommend it that you just keep it, that they can keep on editing it.
Mm-hmm.
Does that make sense? Because they're often they submit it and then they go back and they realize they left something out. So you just need to tell them that I'm looking at them in August, and if it's not finished, I'm just going to look at the answers that you have.
Yeah.
But at the bottom, you need to remind them to always click, because I have a lot of kids who lose what they do on Naviance because they made a mistake to do a back arrow.
And then when they request your letters of recommendation, if your school decides to do letters of recommendation through Naviance, they have to request the teacher on here. So right here where it says letters of recommendation, I can't log on to it because maybe I could. Oh, it doesn't. Because I'm logging in as the counselor, as the student, so it doesn't let me see it. But if you log in as a student, here it just has a drop-down menu. It says has all the names of the teachers that are on Naviance, and they select it, and then they can choose what colleges you want them to write for. I encourage it to select all colleges because it makes your life easier. Instead of uploading one letter per college, can send it to all of them all at once. So that's a decision you guys have to make as a school, but it would be right here. Once they request it, it emails you saying, hey, so-and-so requested a letter of recommendation, and it shows you the deadline of when it is in all the colleges they're applying to. So then you'll have a little bit of access of the teacher's, the student's profile as well. So that's important on there too. Yeah. So that's letters of recommendations. Any questions?
Do you work with your teachers at all for the letters?
I feel like I have to this year because I have a lot of new teachers. Before this year, was a lot of teachers that have been there for a long time. And I think the letters are pretty good. The nice thing about Naviance is that you can snoop around and read all the letters. Like once the teacher all the other letters that you're writing. And so you can technically go to a teacher and say, you know, I noticed that this is what you wrote. What about, you know, adding a little bit more or something? I know private schools, that's what they do. Like, I've talked to some private school, like private high school counselors, and of course they have a caseload of like 20 kids, but they really look at everything that is on that Naviance before they send anything. They read everything for that student. So if they feel that a teacher was not fair enough or did not emphasize enough, they go back to the teacher, and then the teacher has to write it again. So again, I don't know if we can get to that level yet, but it's a possibility, especially if you know there's a teacher out there, you know the teachers, and maybe just kind of do it, but not really. Maybe you can talk to them and give them some PD.
I had a student this year who got, a week before the application was due, the counselor called the parent and said, I don't think we can use one of the letters that were submitted. So who's somebody else that we can pick? And they were able to do it. Within a week, they picked a new person, they dropped that letter, and it was gone.
And I prepped my seniors, or in the beginning of the senior year, like in early September, I go to all the classrooms, and we talk about the process, like how do you apply, how to ask for letters from me and from your teachers. And I really go over who would be the best teachers. Don't just select because, oh, they were nice, or because I have them this year, or because they're the English department chair. Like, choose people that are really going to write something good. And if somebody says no in the beginning, that's probably a reason why. So you might not want to emphasize for them to keep, you know, writing your letter.
Yeah, this is, it was really helpful to see the distinction between teacher and counselor letters of recommendation. But I couldn't write it fast enough for the counselor. Can I get a, like, is there a way I can get a printout, or?
Oh, it's in the Google Docs.
Oh, it is?
Yeah.
Yeah, we put it in there for you.
Oh, great. Okay, thank you. Yeah, but it's really, really helpful.
I've been loading in as many brag sheets and samples as I can get.
Yeah, so I know it's extra time. What I did with LACE is because it's just so many letters, and I can't write letters when I'm in the office because there's kids coming in every other 10 minutes, and Miss, I have this, I have a question, or I have that, or I have a workshop. It just doesn't happen. Like, I've started letters in the beginning of the morning, and it's like the same lines in the morning and at 3 o'clock. So what I negotiated with my principal, and something that you guys can look into if you're writing a lot of letters, is that I take, starting in November, I take one day off a week just to write letters. Because the first year that I was there, I didn't do that, and I was writing letters all winter break, and that was not fun. I don't get paid for that. So I made a point, and it worked, and they said, because they know how heavy of a caseload I have in terms of letter writing, they understood, and was able to work that out.
Your day off is in school, or you're actually at home writing?
At home. I was at home. So if I'm at school, it's not going to happen.
I would negotiate. If you're writing the letters, I would negotiate that.
And I do it, like, I do it on days that I know, like maybe Friday when it's not as busy, or some weeks it wasn't going to happen and it didn't happen. I had to be there that whole week because there was just too much going on. But at least I got that day just to work on stuff.
What was her response? Or his
response is like, okay. But my school, remember, is very college driven. It's very college driven. It's not a question of, like, are you going? It's like, where are you going? So they push college a lot. So, but, you know, once you get that college going culture, then it's understood, like, oh, you're writing letters. These letters are important. You have to take your time, or else it's just going to be a generic letter. And that's not going to help anyone.
I also highly encourage, if you do have a PTA, that if you give the junior teachers, like, a gift card as a result of this, because they're not getting paid to do it. I also encourage all of the students to write formal thank you notes, and
yes.
I expect it to be part of the packet that once the applications are in, they must write a thank you note to the counselor and to their letter. And some of them do it and some of them don't, but they need to learn how to write thank you notes.
Yeah. Okay. That's it.
Thank you, Erica. So I'm going to give you 15 minutes. Go in that sample brag sheet.